we should be enjoying life when it is good, but aware that the good parts don't usually last forever. Neither do the bad parts. One of the great values of stories is to look ahead. They are roadmaps, and they will show you whatever's going on now leads to something else. If it's really bad right now, read ahead a couple pages. Look, see where this is going. Especially if you are able to look around and find variations on your story, get some stories that you're very close to, and then read forward and see what happens. I mean, it's not an exact crystal ball, but we are not inventing life. Others have come this way before. They've left a few clues for us. We don't have to stumble around in the darkness all the time. We can read the guidebook. It is folklore, it is mythology, it is this body of wisdom literature that has been left behind. Some are retold and we can find the author, Hans Christian Andersen or something like that, but mostly those are based on older tales and those are based on older tales, so actually the wisdom is much earlier than the actual text we are considering here. The brothers Grimm and Perrault in France gathered these tales from the grandmothers, but they were old, old stories. First of all, the grandmothers had heard them in their childhood, but they were much older than that. So we're tapping into, if you will, the eternal guidance of the species when we revisit these stories. So it did not work out at home. It did not work out in the barnyard. We had to go off. We went to the wild place. Is that perhaps the encounter with our own unconscious? There's a wetlands that is the, James Hollis calls it the swamplands of the soul, new life in dismal places. You've had him speak here, he's absolutely brilliant. And he's talking about the value of the setback, the value of the distressing emotional part of the road where things are really rocky, where we really wonder if we can make it, where we're in despair, where we feel betrayed, where we're in anxiety so terrible we don't know if we can breathe, that stuff. That out of that, the good part will come. Out of that, the vision will come, the transformative possibility, the bit of guidance. Dr. Jung said, the gold will be found in the shadow, in the part of ourselves we've never been comfortable with, the part that we kind of wished would go away, the part we're hoping no one else can see. By the way, that one doesn't work. They're usually able to see it better than we are, so hiding it, we're only kidding ourselves. And of course, the project is not eradication. You don't get rid of shadow. The project is coming to terms with it. It's this part of myself that I've always been distressed about. What am I to do with this thing? What is this? Sarah sits there causing trouble. What am I to do with it? I'm to put a place at the table for it. I'm to find a way to have it be on the team. I'm to find integration. Dr. Jung's emphasis was always on wholeness. Claim the many elements of this gift, the many aspects of the human endowment, all this stuff, all these parts of me, sometimes not getting along with each other. Figure out a way to make the whole thing work. In the mythic moment, the parts of ourselves we like, which we admire, which we know are some good, will be maximized or really put to good use. And the part of ourselves we've never had much use for will suddenly play a vital part, that suddenly come in handy. The thing that's always been a little awkward, the thing's a little bit ugly, the thing that somehow I was embarrassed about will be necessary. Thank goodness, in the end, I was not able to get rid of it.